Welcome to Classic Talk with Bing and Dennis. Today our guest is Semyon Bychkov, the music director and chief conductor of the Czech Philharmonic and guest conductor this week at the New York Philharmonic. Thank you very much for joining us.
Good to have you.
Thank you.
When did you first in your life even think about a career as a conductor?
I reckon it would have been around the age of nine.
Nine?
Maybe a little sooner than that.
Precocious comes
to
mind.
Maybe eight. You know, I entered Glinka Choir School in St. Petersburg, at the time Leningrad, at the age of seven. And all of us would be singing in the boys' choir. And our conductor was the first prototype of a conductor. And so singing with him, watching him, somehow gave the idea that this is how I wanted to express myself through music. So I imagine that was the time when it all started.
So what did you do about this urge?
Well, actually, that school is quite unique because you studied there both academic and musical subjects, all mixed up. And you do that for 10 years. And as several years pass by, first you sing in the choir, you play piano, you study all kinds of solfege, ear training, harmony, counterpoint, plus literature and mathematics, all of those things. And then at the age of 13, they start teaching you choral conducting, because the idea is to train choral conductors at the end of the 10-year period. And so at the age of 13, for the first time, I was actually conducting our own choir, which is what we all did. I also started attending the class of Ilya Musin at the conservatory, which was a class of orchestral conducting, because by then it was clear to me that I wanted to express all kinds of music and not only choral music.
What was the first time when you conducted chorus? What kind of a feeling do you have? Were you nervous?
Of course you're nervous to stand in front of your peers and tell them how you would like them to sing and how you want to express whatever the piece
But you
is
were
about.
So young then.
Yes, and yet, I don't know, it felt natural.
Mm.
It felt as natural as several years later when for the first time I stood in front of an orchestra. It was during the entrance exams to enter the conservatory. And it was a very tough process. There were 78 of us that were being auditioned. I was the youngest one at the age of 17. It never happened in history there that someone so young would be even admitted to the orchestral conducting exams. They always felt that one had to have lived long enough and have done other things in composition or musicology or any instrument, etc., before one could attempt to study conducting. And here I am coming as a 17-year-old person. And it was a process consisting of many different stages, after which there was a certain number of candidates that was eliminated. I made it to the final round, which was conducting an orchestra. It was the professional orchestra at the conservatory, who was also playing at the opera house of the conservatory, and as well as for the conducting students and giving concerts. So they were the ones that I would conduct for the first time, and I chose Brahms' First Symphony. There were 18 of us for that final round, and each one had a certain amount of time in order to conduct.
What did you think then?
Actually, it was quite amusing because there were very many who have been trying for years unsuccessfully to enter. And some of them managed to reach that final round unsuccessfully. And they were standing outside of the hall where it was taking place.
Were you worried about it?
Well, of course I was nervous. It's absolutely natural. And they were telling me, well, you know, when you go on that podium, the sounds that you will hear have nothing to do with what you're used to hearing when you're in the audience. It's a very different kind of sound. You will be immersed in this thing and you won't be able to tell really the difference because everything will sound very strange. So I went on stage prepared for it sounding strange. And in fact, as I started, I realized that I heard everything, and it felt completely natural, and it was something that's where I belonged. And I was that lucky one that was accepted. You know, the everything was regimented by the Ministry of Culture. And as only one student conductor graduated the previous year, only one could have been accepted. And that one person, lucky one, was me.
Did you come from a music family?
Yes and no. My father was a scientist. My mother studied piano as a young person in her childhood. Then when the war started, it was interrupted and she never went back to it. Her father was a doctor, but an amateur composer. So there was music in that side of the family. And the father of my grandfather was a conductor of Odessa Opera House. In the late 19th, early 20th century. And so something must have passed through the genes.
You have a brother who's also a conductor, is that right?
Yes, I did. He passed away, sadly, as a young person. Mm-hmm. But yes, he also was a conductor. Yeah.
Now, I'm interested in, once you're into the conservatory, is it conservatory? I know that pianists practice 8 hours a day, as do violinists. When you're studying to be a conductor, what do you study? Obviously, everything about transposition and the instruments, but what do you actually, as far as technique, how much studying is there to do?
Plenty. And my great privilege was to become pupil of Ilya Musin. This man, who was a pupil of Nicholas Malko, he started teaching conducting in 1920s as a very young man, having just finished his own studies. And so that went on all the way until the end of his rather long life. He died at the age of 96. He continued all the way until that time. And I don't know, there are thousands of pupils that passed through his class. And what was very unique about him is that he was really the first person who has understood the process of conducting as a visual art. You know, if you take a piano and you have no technique to play it, it will not work. Conducting requires also a technique, except you will be conducting a human instruments as opposed to a mechanical ones, but technique is still necessary. And what he was able to do is to formulate that technique, pass it on to his students, and the technique was there as the means of expression. So the gesture of a conductor has to contain many different things. At once, it has to be clear to the colleagues who will be playing what the tempo will be, so that they will start together, they will continue together and finish together. Right. And that is a technical aspect of it. But the gesture also must contain the character of music that is being expressed. And that was a very unique genius of this man, that he explained to us, transmitted to us, and that was kind of an invaluable help that I had by being his pupil.
What is most important skill, you call it, and from him that at a time when you were with him?
Well, of course, it is a technical ability, that's clear, but there is more to it. I couldn't probably name a single element that was the most important, but maybe the attitude to the profession itself. It's the attitude to the art form, responsibility towards it, in my case, as a conductor, but it's exactly the same for instrumentalists or singers. Responsibility of an interpreter, and the understanding that there are so many ways to interpret a piece of music, which always remains the same, but we change as we go through life. And that precludes dogma. And in that sense, he was a very enlightened person and often quite different from his own colleagues, one of whom said once during one of the lessons that he was giving, was a conducting teacher, a renowned conductor, and we were always visiting the classes of the other professors. It was a permanent visitation. So you ended up studying with many of them by observing, even though you had your own teacher. And that man said once, he said to all of us, and there were quite a few present, you are not allowed to touch Mozart's G minor symphony until you're at least 50 years old.
Do you agree?
I was quite shocked by that statement, and there was a silence. And then I asked the question, I said, Maestro, and what if I don't live to be 50? It means that I can never come in contact with the Mozart's G minor symphony?
What age did he give to the Wagner Ring?
Well, that music at that time was not performed. And so there was no discussion. But of course, we all know that Mozart's music and the music of that period, Mozart, Haydn, Beethoven, of course, it is maybe the most difficult music to interpret. That is clear. But in my view, the sooner we come in contact with the greatest masterpieces, the better it is, because it means we will have longer time in our life to live with them.
Put them aside for a while and then come back.
Exactly,
and then back.
Exactly.
When you were studying, were you able to listen to recordings? Did you have conductors that you admired?
Oh, yes, absolutely. Of course, we did not have as wide a range available as people in the West would have had. But still, we knew the recordings of Karajan and Furtwängler and Toscanini and Abendroth and Knappertsbusch, and we had Mravinsky conducting Leningrad Philharmonic for 50 years and also observing his rehearsals. And so there were plenty of artists that we could admire by knowing their work and always curious at the solutions they found to the problems that everyone will face. This tempo, this transition, this approach, this point of view. That's something that was terribly important for us. And one understands that there is a great plurality available to interpreters. You see, today, early music is so important in the life of society. Musicians playing on period instruments. Those artists who devoted their life to researching the period practice of early music, its phrasing, its articulation, its sound, such things. And you look at some of them who are really in the forefront since quite a long time. I will give you an example of someone like Harnoncourt and Gardiner. Both have read the same books and often arrive at very different conclusions. Equally exciting, equally valuable. And so one understands that the only thing that is absolute is the effort one makes. The result is always relative.
So you didn't have one of these conductors that you ended up admiring?
Not one. But there are many that I admire to this day, and I admired then. And I mentioned already some of them.
When you were young, when you study all the music and listen to all these very famous some people that you admire, were you afraid to influence by them or the direction, you know, you might diminish your feelings and everything?
No, I was never afraid of that.
No.
I was never afraid of that. I know that there is a concern that if we are too much exposed to outside influence, we are in danger of losing our own way of expressing music. I never felt that danger. I never thought I had that problem. And to this day, I'm interested to know what other colleagues do with music. At the same time, if I return to Brahms Symphony No. 4, as this last week with the New York Philharmonic, I don't know how many scores of that symphony I have worked with. It's the same symphony, but there are many scores that I went through. And every time I come back to it, I want to start with a clean copy, because you end up seeing things
right,
which are untouched by your own markings. And the same way you try to sort of abstract yourself from the experiences or experience of doing it and try to feel it as if you're feeling it for the first time. It's a challenge, but it can be met successfully if you love the object of the attention.
I have the feeling you're not one of these conductors who writes, fills his music with so many marks, three here, four here, two here.
No, that is not important. But what is important, for example, is the structure of the piece, because there are phrases. A phrase may last one bar or one and a half bars or three bars or four, etc. And in a way, it's like a skeleton of the piece. And it's very important to realize how that being is made. So you realize that this is how the bones are connected. And over those bones is the flesh. And the flesh is the actual expression. But without the bones, the flesh will not hold. So it's the construction of the piece which is terribly important. And yes, I mark it in the score, the construction. And sometimes I will have an idea for expression itself, and I will write it in. And before you know it, it starts accumulating. And after that, you don't see the notes anymore.
Exactly.
So you try to start with a clean copy.
So in other words, you never worry whether it's going to be the same from the last time you did it.
No, I'm not worried. And I tell you why. I don't think any musician is able to repeat twice the same phrase in exactly the same way.
Mm-hmm. But you often hear a conductor will say, or a musician will say, that's exactly, I know the piece. I know how to do it exactly the way it's supposed to be. What does that really mean?
That can mean a deep conviction about the work and how you would like to express it. But the moment you start expressing it, something will happen, will deviate you from your maybe original intention. Could be anything. It depends on, let's say, an orchestra. They're all different, like human beings. It's just an assembly of human beings, but they're all different. So you will hear things that will somehow deviate you from where you wanted to go. And then you have to decide whether this is the way you want to go or you still want to go your way and convince your colleagues to do that. It really works like that. But none of us is able to repeat. Yes, we can repeat it in the same tempo, but it will not be quite the same. It will not be a photocopy. If it is, then it's a pity. Because the whole idea of music is something that exists at its moment and therefore must be spontaneous. In the recording process, live recordings is something else because they reflect the performance itself that takes place right now. It's a document of this moment. A studio recording that lasts sometimes, well, in Prague, we would record the Tchaikovsky Symphony for 1 week. And we will repeat many times the same movement, certain passages that are not yet good enough. And then it is always very important to preserve the spontaneity and not to go through the motions by, let's say, dialing the score.
Mm-hmm. That's more difficult in a studio recording.
It is more difficult in a studio recording, yes. It is more difficult. However, even there is a way to deal with it simply because if you record in a studio something that you have not lived with or the orchestra has not lived with, then it is just getting the notes right. That is only the first step of interpretation. When you record something that you have lived with together, in Prague, we will rehearse, we will perform at home, we'll take it on tour, we leave it alone, we'll come back to it, and then we will record it. So then the recording process, in a way, is very similar to a performance because we are free with it. And so sometimes I will try a very different approach to a transition or to even a basic tempo can happen because that's such a subjective thing. In the end, what you're convinced by today may not be something that will convince you tomorrow. So you try something else and you accumulate the material. And then comes the editing process when you listen to the playbacks and you try to identify something that sounds most convincing to you at this particular moment. And then you have to make sure that it works in the framework of the whole.
Is that part of the process enjoyable to you, or is that tedious? Or
no, it's not tedious. It is tremendously creative. Tremendously creative. It's very tough because for orchestra musicians to survive repeating the same passage again and again until it sounds convincing and it sounds right, not only sounds together, It requires tremendous concentration and brings enormous fatigue. But when the result is convincing, then it's a gratifying type of fatigue. You know, microphone, like a camera, is the best teacher, because when you watch yourself or you listen to yourself while not doing it at the moment, your reaction to it is fairly objective. So it is the best teacher. It can be the best friend, and it's usually the worst enemy.
But at the end of the day, do you feel live and recording still the difference, right?
It is different.
But which one would you prefer?
It really depends on the circumstances. A live recording can be outstanding. We know it from plenty of examples, especially if there are several performances where you have an opportunity to express the piece and then choose the material that will be of real quality. But the studio recording gives you an opportunity to repeat as many times as time will allow and to try things that you cannot do in a single performance. You see, if we have to walk from here to Carnegie Hall, if we know the city, we know lots of different ways to get there. It's the same with a piece of music. To get from the first note to the last one, there are so many different ways that you can take, but you can only take one road at a time in a live performance. In a recording, you can try plenty of different things. So it's just a different medium, but equally valid.
Now, back to the conservatory. How did you go through the conservatory? Wonderful, smooth?
Well, it was already amazing that I was accepted.
Sure.
At the age of 17.
That's right.
It was amazing that I had an opportunity to conduct the first opera at the age of 19, and that was...
What was the opera?
Eugene Onegin of Tchaikovsky. Wow. And I had 20 performances to conduct.
Wow.
With the conservatory or...?
They call it opera studio, which is essentially an opera house. As part of the conservatory, the orchestra is entirely professional. Some of the singers are in the ensemble professional. Some of the singers are students given an opportunity to interpret various roles. It's an unbelievable experience.
Before the first performance, how many hours did you study?
Oh, I don't know. But, you know, this particular opera is one of the first loves in my life. There were three at the time. It was Onegin, Carmen, and Traviata.
Is that right?
And during those years of being a teenager, well, there were three opera houses in the city. Mariinsky, Mali, and the opera house of the conservatory. Those three operas were in repertoire, which means on any given week you could hear at least once each of the three operas, and I almost never missed a performance. I knew all the artists singing all those roles. I was obsessed with the music, with some of the artists singing those roles, and so it was something that really meant a great deal.
That's how you started your career there?
That's how
there.
It started, yes.
We'll take it from there. We have to stop for a break, unfortunately, but we'll start up right where we left off. This is Classic Talk with Bing and Dennis, and we have the great pleasure today of speaking with Semyon Bychkov.